So my name is Julien Pivoteau and I am a contributor on the MGMT project. In the meantime, I am working in the IT since 2011. And what I wanted to show to you today and to see with you is actually the MGMT project, so who has been at previous Config Management Camp before this year. So if you have, you probably already know about MGMT because James is talking about it quite a lot. But the issue with this one is that a lot of people just come to James Talks just to see the fireworks and the special effects and all the cool stuff, but no one has actually at the end a clear idea about what MGMT is actually doing, right? Because we all like James, we all like everything he does, but MGMT is doing a lot of different stuff, and I want to kind of dive with you about all of them. So let's get back to configuration management. So the idea of configuration management, this is a very simplified version, but you have a system, should it be a server, should it be a cluster, should it be a disaster anyway, that certain have a state and you want to move it to the next one. So you want to apply configuration to the system so that it behaves just like you want. And then you have two different ways to do that. So you can just decide, okay, I know what I want. I want that final state, or I want to do this and this. So basically, you have a system that will just config management system that will be declarative, and other ones that will be declarative imperative. So you probably know the tools behind that. So if I say that I want a package to be installed and that kind of configuration and crafting, then you are more in the Puppet world. And if you say that you want to do this, then this, then this, then this, and kind of some kind of pre-books, then you are more in the mode of Ansible. And that works quite well, right? Because like, I think if you are there today, it's because you are already using configuration management tools. So why would you need a new one? What would a new one bring to your daily work? So there are some cases when you want to change the state. So when you have a working situation, it's fine. But when you start adding servers, when you start adding services, when the ecosystem is changing, sometimes it's quite hard to do this. Or sometimes you, even if it's everything is in the code, changing a little thing has a lot of consequences on that code itself, so on that configuration management code. So configuration management works really well when you know what you want, when you know everything about the system that you manage. But sometimes there are changes, and some changes you can predict them. If you add a server, then you know that you are adding a new server. If you add a service, you probably know about it. Sometimes you just don't know. Sometimes it is something that's crashing, or it is just like you kind of want to add new stuff or to react directly on events that you didn't anticipate. Or sometimes you don't know what's the state of your infrastructure when you deploy it. And for that kind of status, when you actually have some kind of changes that you don't actually know, then the tooling, yeah, you don't really have a lot of tooling around that. I'm thinking further than just service coverage, it's really a lot more stuff, so we will go into details now. So here comes MGMT, so MGMT config. But what is actually MGMT? So you know that it has been there for quite a long time now, so basically since 2015. So with just those words, you don't know actually what MGMT is. So let's go about the buzzwords. So MGMT, what can we do about it? Well, basically it will handle events, put them into a graph with vertices, and then you have a language. It's a new DSL, which you shouldn't do, but it's 2015, so it doesn't count. And then you have resources, so that's basically all the buzzwords that are around MGMT. But now I want to get back to each one of them and to see exactly what they mean for the infrastructure, what they mean, what problem they will solve for you. So MGMT is event-based. It means that everything in MGMT will be starting from events. So it will not start from something that you will decide, that you will say, okay, now I want to do this. You will not be like the input for the majority of the changes. So what are events? An event can be that you add a new server, that you remove a file, that the service is responding. So you have a lot of events inside of your infrastructure, inside of your application. And MGMT can actually see those events and directly react to that. The other kind of events happen outside of the infrastructure. You could have like some external partners that are not working. You could have new package updates that are available. Or you could simply have like more traffic in your platform. All those are events that you can use that can affect the way that your application works, that you want to manage your data center. If the external connectivity is not working, maybe I want to stop running some batches, I want to stop some services, or I want to fix the connectivity by switching my uplink, I don't know. If my package updates are available, maybe I want to update them, I want to see, to deploy the new version, a lot of stuff that I might want to do when there is a package update. When there is more traffic on the platform, maybe I want to launch more processes, I want to do some stuff at new VMs, that kind of things. All of that are events that you can react upon. So those are other examples that you could have, like when I add a new server, I'm sure that it is in the DNS, that if I have quorum-based application, they take that into consideration, that the application is inside the front end, or that at certain time of the day I can enable or disable services. So basically, maybe you have more traffic in the day, then at night you don't need, or you want to use another kind of services, you can do that. So all of that are stuff that you can do. So here is an example from GMT config that will actually based on an event, which is in this case a query that we make in the monitoring system. And based on that event, which will be like at some point, if there is more than 300 requests to that part, then I want to disable a batch because I know that maybe I don't want to do some part of the business which is asynchronous. I want to pause that for the moment. And when it will be less than 300, I can just do like re-enable that. So that's the idea about events, that like this code, I will not change it 3 times a day to say, oh no, the request is too high, no, I will change the rule. The rule is there and basically it will be like compiled by MGMT and MGMT will know, okay. Now I will watch all the time, I will receive the events from Prometheus to see, okay, now I need to do something about this, now I need to react. And you don't have anything else to do. It also means that you can have a variable with the number of servers, and every time there will be a new server around, what will you do? Well, it will be recompiled to a new desired state that will be applied by MGMT. So let's come to the state. So what do you actually know about your infrastructure? Well, in MGMT, you don't need to know anything in advance because the desired state, you don't define it. It's not the piece that you define. What you define will be some piece of code that will be recalculated every time the input is changing. It means that if you have your modules in MGMT, well, what they will look like at the end, you cannot predict it easily because it will depend on what MGMT will receive as events when it will run. So MGMT is designed to run all the time. It will always watch all the events that are happening in your data center, in your infrastructure. And then when there is some deviation, it will first fix the deviation, and if that is changing its output or its or the way that it should compile that graph, it will recompile it. So it enables you to have quite complex setups, but when you change something, you don't need to rechange everything. So there is a big difference between, in this case, we have a desired state that is based on facts and on events. So the desired state is not the piece that you focus on. What you focus on is the code that will create that desired state. It's not like other tools when you just need to adapt the desired state when you add a new machine, when you change something in your structure, so that is quite slow to react. And it's not also the same as just running a bunch of commands and see at the end you just don't know the final state anymore. Okay, so we have seen the basics about the events, and I know that James will do a demo after this talk, so you will have all the demo you want after that. So let's see what's included. So when I started in 2011, one of the first things I got at my job was this. It was basically like how to deploy a service in Puppet, and it was just, you know, 90% of the services are just package, file and service. And that's still true today. So you don't need a lot to start to deploy services. You just need the package, the config, the service. It's still true for a lot of stuff. And of course, you will find that in MGMT as well. So that's the basic. That gets you quite far already if you have sensible software. And then you can go further with MGMT. So out of the box, you'll also be able to manage network interfaces, mount points, timers and cron jobs, so all of that will be able to manage them with MGMT. And if you actually do manage them with MGMT, MGMT will never like just create it and not look at it. It will create it and then watch for something to happen with that. So if I decide in MGMT that I want a mount point like this, so it will mount it. And if by accident someone is unmounting it, MGMT will see, hey, but my state wants me to have it mounted, and it will directly mount it again. Which also means that you don't need to wait for 30 minutes to have it fixed. You know that your infrastructure is like you want all the time. Next set of resources, well, you can execute commands, create users, create groups. You can also interact with OGIA, so if you have seen the Ignite yesterday, you can just decide that in your SSHD config, the root login will always be no, and if someone tries to change that, it will be changed back directly to no. You can interact with service discovery like console, and then you can go one step further. So you can also like manage containers with MGMT. You can create VMs, you can create EC2 machines, so you can do a lot of stuff with MGMT at this stage. So that's the batteries in terms of what you know as resources that are included in MGMT. Then you will have external events. So currently there is not a lot of them. More important ones are the time and the file, so you can change things based on time, changing based on files, there will be more to come. But basically, the system of MGMT means that you can take all of those things and apply them to resources. So if the time is changing, if the file is changing, you can do a lot of different things based on what you will get from those inputs. And as I said, each one of the resources, they have their own events, which means that if I look at a file and someone is changing it, MGMT will change it back. And if it cannot change the file back, then it will notice me and I can actually know, okay, no, I am not in the state I want. But I know that MGMT did try to fix that. The next thing that's very important about MGMT is something that can enable us to work better. And when I say is that, when I think about machines, I think that the machine should help me. So when you look at the traditional dependency management in the other tools, either you need to define your dependencies, like please only create the file when I have installed the package. So that takes a lot of time to figure out, okay, that package needs that file or that service needs that package. And then you also have the ability to just say, okay, no, I want people to learn my tool quite fast, so I will just say, here is a list. And I will just apply it in the same order. So if you have dependencies, just put the dependencies at the bottom of the file and then it will just be applied in the same order as you write it. So that's very, very easy, but in practice that's very slow as well. So that's the current state of the tools that most of the tools that I know. There are some improvements in that state in some tools, of course, but basically it's the two basic ones. But the thing is that when it comes to traditional Unix management, you know that when you have a package, that package will contain files. And you can list those files in advance. So before you install a package, you can see, okay, that package will install that and that command, or that cron job, it is using that command. Oh, but that command, I know that it's not on the machine, it's on that specific package. So basically, I can take those commands, and then MGMD, if I ask him to run a command, and that he sees that the command is included in the package that I have, if the package is not in the state that MGMT wants it, then it will just install the package first. So that's called auto-edges, and that basically is something that I think all the continuous management tools should have. And it's really helpful because as humans, we don't want to think about the things that the machine already has, right? The machine knows all of that. Why should I tell the machine again? So all that magic is happening in the MGMT engine. So I've given the example on the files and the packages, but you can imagine that there is a lot more to that. And as MGMT will explain in the future, there will be more of those auto edges so that it will discover more and more dependencies between all those events-based resources. The next thing will be the auto grouping. So what does it mean? It means that if I ask my package manager to install 10 packages, do I really want to install them one by one? You know, some package managers, they will like take 5 minutes to just get the metadata, to get a bunch of preparation things. So if you just can install them all in once, you get you earn a lot of time. And MGMT can do that out of the box as well, and that's pretty nice. So when it will decide what to do, it will say, okay, I can do this and this together. So this is an example about the packages, but it can be about any other resources that supports that. The next part is the language. So implementing events in the language is not something that's easy. And it's actually hard to reuse a programming language because you don't want to support all its features, especially since in MGMT, it's kind of compiled all in one. I mean that it's close to a functional language, which means that the order when you put the variables in the file, it doesn't really matter. So basically, a new language was, the best suited for this. So now I will show you some of the examples that we have in the language. Oops. So I will directly go to the website of MGMT to show you that. Like this. Oops. This. Okay. Here we go. So you have a bunch of examples in the MGMT repository. Some of them are still in YAML. So before there was an actual MGMT language, there was a YAML way of writing things that is no longer the case now. Well, YAML is there as an intermediate step and you should not care about it. So let's look at the example of the language. So if you have used Puppet already, then you will probably recognize this. So basically, MGMT was started in 2015, and there is a lot of inspiration from the Puppet world. So this looks like kind of Puppet resources. So this is a very static definition of what MGMT can do. So in this case, there is no apparent magic. The only magic that's there is that if I now remove the cron job or change it, then it will actually like be changed back. So even if we didn't write any logic around events there, the engine behind it knows all about this, all about the logic that is needed to do this. Another example. So this example will actually like look at the current date and update that in the file. So you will have a file that will contain the current date. Why is that important? It is because in this case you see that the $d variable is actually listening to some events that are coming from the dateTime function, and every second the dateTime function will come and say, hey, no, it is that time, that time. So that file will be constantly updated. Still, that's pretty basic example, and you could do that with other languages. Now if we go to more complex stuff, so let's look at what we have there. So do we have something interesting in those containers? Let me find one. So here we have another example based on the time. Except that this one will actually like look be more advanced and start computing between different stuff that it gets as input. So in this case, we will look if it's Friday, and then you see that there is a lot more logic that you can do. So this is really like infrastructure coding, like, so you can actually code a lot of stuff. You have a full language with conditions that you can use. So in this case, we are setting a variable S2, and if it's Friday, you will have like it's Friday, and then you have other content depending on the other days. At the end, you can reuse all of that, and actually if it's Friday, you see that you will have a condition that will say no, it's Friday, you cannot write that file. So that could be a number of virtual machines, that could be a bunch of different stuff, and all of that will be computed all the time. And what will happen then is that there will be a state generated, and if there is a change, the engine will just look, okay, my new state looks like this, I need to do all the actions, and then I am done. If I go to this one, I think is an interesting one. No, it's not that one. That one. So that one. So that one, you see first that you have a pretty static virtual machine there that is defined. That will have one CPU, that will have some memory, that will be running. But on the top, what do you have? You will have actually like, you will look at the load average of the machine. And basically you will see that if we will define some threshold, and like if the load average is behind such a threshold, then you will actually decide that a second virtual machine will be shut off or running. So basically, depending on the state of the current machine of the server, you will have more or less virtual machines running. So that's already a next step than just playing with files, right? It's shutting down, running a virtual machine there. So here you start seeing the power of MGMT, right? It's actually based on something that I don't know at the beginning. So when I decide to deploy my infrastructure, I don't know the load of that on that machine, and I don't know what it will be in 10 minutes, and I don't know. So basically, this is quite a nice solution to have. So I directly know, okay, I know in that condition I want this, and in this other condition I want that. And that's really difficult to model in the other configuration management languages. So. And
let me get back. Okay.
So, some more examples there. Monitoring. So, in the traditional configuration management area, it's kind of hard to monitor the state of your config management. And it is so hard that you have some configuration management tools that are specialized into that. But what you actually want to know is like, how is my infrastructure changing? And is it how I like it? So is it matching my current state? So for that, MGMT has promoted some embedded, which means that you can see at which rate your infrastructure is changing, how many events does MGMT get, and is it still needed to run some manual actions or to investigate failing issues? So all of that, you can get that easily with Prometheus integration that's in MGMT. It also enables you to notice, okay, I see that at the time of the day, my infrastructure is changing a lot, more than I expect, so you can actually react based upon that. So you actually get to know your infrastructure better. So why did I actually decide to do this talk? So the main issue about MGMT, I think, is that it has been presented really early. And at the beginning, it was only about changing files and writing YAML. So basically, it was really hard to understand what it was going to be at the end. And now we are quite close to something that's really good and really usable. So I wanted to share with you what I've learned about MGMT over the years. And it's really, really important that we kind of start looking into it and that we can together see how we can bring that and use that in for more and more use cases. GMT is quick, it's efficient. So basically, I don't think that there is any other tool that can act quicker on the infrastructure. So there's still work to do, but really it's something that's very elegant. When you see all the features like the auto edges, the auto grouping, it's a lot of stuff that you don't have to do anymore because MGMT will do it for you. And it also enables you to maintain your state over time and almost in real time. So that's really, really important to know that we now have that kind of solutions around. We can actually use that. And the solution isn't always Kubernetes, right? So I encourage you to look at MGMT. So unfortunately there is no website yet. So the best location you can go is actually the GitHub page, and here you will see you will be able to read about the documentation. So there is quite extensive documentation to get started with. So if you want to develop or to learn about it, then you have a lot of places when you can reach the community. You have a lot of places when you can see some tools that have been done, and you have all the code that is free to look at and free to contribute to. So just feel free to come to the community, ask questions, try it, and give us your input also. So that's very important for the project, and we really hope that it will be successful in the coming years. Okay. Now, thank you. If you have any questions, I will answer them happily. Yes?
How does it work? Does it have a central server where the configurations and variables are stored? Or how it works?
And also the servers, they work together with the RAF protocol. So basically you don't have a central server, but you will have a cluster. So if you have a single point of failure, it's not the goal of MGMT. So basically what it does, it has embedded its CD, and then that embedded CD will elect some masters, but all of that will be redundant, and so it's decentralized.
So those files do exist?
So they exist on all the nodes, basically.
But if I want to change one, if I want to say instead of Friday, Thursday, put it on red on me, where do I change?
So when you change the files, they can be shared between the servers. There are still some work in progress in that area, and I know that the code is executed on every one of the machines, so it will be based on the events of that specific machine. So if you want to do some stuff specific to some host, you can actually check, okay, am I in this cluster, and that kind of things. So all of that, there is still some stuff in work in progress around that kind of features, but you can already try that out. So yeah. And it's always compiled locally, so each machine will maintain its own state, its own graph, currently. Okay, thank you. So James will be there for the next talk, and he will give more demos around MGMT, so we'll be able to learn even more about it. Thank you.